So when you go to John's Gospel, chapter 5, we're going to read now the story about Jesus, the Son of God. It says here, sometime later, from verse 1, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for a feast of the Jews. Verse 2, now there is in Jerusalem near the sheep gate a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by 5 covered colonnades. Here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. And one who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. And while I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." And at once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. Amen. There's so much secrets in this text. Let us reveal some of them tonight. Can we do that? There's so much amazing revelations in this little text. First of all, we need to understand that there was some kind of a legendary pool that they were talking about here. We don't hear that Jesus is denying what is happening at this pool, isn't it? And the author here, John, is not denying it either. So there was some kind of a phenomena taking place at this pool. Would you agree with me? From time to time, an angel would step down into the water and stir the water, and the first one down in the water that was stirred would be healed. So here, a number of people, many, many people, were laying, waiting for that healing lottery. Does that make sense to you? They were laying there because they had seen people get well, get healed, once they came down into the stirred water. I think it is a tragic story, isn't it? Somehow it's tragic. People are laying around, and handicapped gathered, and disabled people gathered, and some were there probably for decades. We don't know how long this man has been there. The Bible tells us that he's been an invalid for 38 years. We don't know if he'd been around that pool for 30 years. And I mean, he tells Jesus that no one, I mean, every time I try, someone else gets ahead of me. And so he had seen the water being stirred many times. He had seen the angel step down. So it was not just something that happened every 50 years or so. It happened pretty occasionally. And he had seen it, and he had missed every opportunity, he felt like. And there's something in this text that I wanted to see. First of all, there is a man that is waiting for a healing lottery. And he is thinking, this is how it should happen. So he has his thought pattern very firm. Does that make sense? The angel will step down into the water. He will stir the water. I will get down into it first. The angel will step down into the water. He will stir the water, and I will get down fast and first. So this is his thought process, and this is why he's not putting his eyes off the pool. He is just laying there waiting for the phenomena to take place so that he can get down first. And then Jesus comes along, and I love the story that, because it's just how we are sometimes. We are focused on a miracle, and we have heard how that miracle has taken place in other people's lives. And we have heard how they have experienced God, and we have some kind of a pattern in our head, isn't it, about how it will take place and how we will experience God. And here we are, the angel is going to get down into the water will be stirred, and I will get down in first, and then I will be in. And here we are, and we are focused on that. And as we are focused on that, we can miss what God actually is doing among us. We can miss that Jesus comes walking by. We can miss God by being so stuck in our thought patterns. Can you see what I'm saying? It's an absolutely astonishing story. I'm now trying in my third language here. I hope I get through to you, all right? It's not easy for me to preach in English. Every time when I get a little fired up, I want to use other words, okay? I want to start to shout around in either German or Swedish, all right? But I only cast out demons in German. Okay, that was a bad joke. All right, let's move on. But I want you to see this, that you can miss God by being charismatic, stuck in how you are going to experience God. Does this make sense? If you've been around, you know, Pentecostalism or charismatic church or revival ministries or healing ministries, and you can actually be almost stuck in your thoughts somehow, so that you can miss when God shows up, because this is how He's going to show up and this is how I will experience Him. But don't you dare to put God in a box. He is bigger than the box. Are you here? Of a Pentecostal church or a revival church or whatever. He's bigger. He's bigger. And you can miss Jesus when He comes along. I think it is just, I've seen it, and I think it is almost hysterical. A laugh. Because I see this invalid doesn't take his eyes off the pool. And Jesus stands there and He says, so for how long? 38 years. And he's looking at the pool. Yeah, but do you really want to get well? And now he's being angry. Or at least that is what I think he must have been. Because this is a rude question. How many of you would agree with me? If you've been waiting for 3 decades, if you've been around and you've missed every occasion and someone asks you, do you really want to get well? Well, what am I doing here? What am I doing here? Why do I ask my brother to accompany me, to carry me down? Why do I ask my cousins to be here? Come on, I'm right here. But the thing is that Jesus is asking me this question that I freely want to interpret for you today. How much do you want to get healed? Isn't it? How much? Sometimes we say we want stuff, isn't it? We want to give it all for Jesus until there's a sniper in the crowd. We want to give it all for Jesus until there are Taliban's blowing up. We want to give it all for Jesus until it costs us something. Someone asked me the other day, should we give 10% under the new covenant of love and grace that came through Jesus? So what should we give? I said, 10%? That's ridiculous. Under the new covenant of grace, we give 100%. We give everything. We lay down our lives, our wallets, isn't it? Our bank accounts, our time, our families, our houses, our cars, everything belongs to Him who bought us with His precious blood. I don't know about you, but I was saved by Jesus. And Jesus stepped into my world and He shook my world. And He did my world differently. And today, I have this in my spirit to deliver to you. And I would like to ask you, just like Jesus asked this man at the pool of Bethesda, how much do you want what you say you want? How much? You're praying for revival. You're praying for healing. You're praying for this. You pray, you say, Lord, I'm ready. How much? Is it worth your career? Is it worth your education? Is it worth your... You see, I'm going to speak now, because I've lived this Book of Acts life for 25 years. So I'm going to speak this now, and I will hold nothing back. And I will ask you, how much do you really want to get healed? How much do you really want to experience that deeper thing in God? Some of you don't know that it is not until you have a gun unto your head
that you really experienced the real joy and satisfaction of living for Jesus. Some of you don't know that it is not until you have been thrown in prison that you lay there and you feel, hallelujah, now I qualify with Paul and Timothy and all the others. Are you speaking out of experience now? Yes, I am. Some of you don't know that it is not until you've given everything that you will experience everything. So when Jesus asked this guy here in this text, how much do you want to get well? It's a relevant question.
I know some of you will get mad tonight, but that's good. That's part of a revival service, you see. We revive and stir everything. I never forget, Peter, when we were in southern Nepal together. Do you remember these Hindus there? They were radical. They climbed our rig. But now we're not talking those people that had hands and feet to climb the rig. We're talking about the people in the wheelchairs that were lame from waist down. They were climbing the rig. They rolled our wheelchairs up to where they could get to the steel. And then they started climbing with their arms. And 3-4 people got out where the speakers were hanging and the lights were hanging as I was preaching, hanging there. And then they dropped themselves in front of me, bang, on the stage and screamed something. I couldn't understand it. But my interpreter said, holy man, heal me. Are you getting it? And here you got to stand in some churches in America and Europe and persuade people to come to the altar. I mean, it's ridiculous. Can we talk here? Oh, if I'm going to come to the altar, this preacher will have to have a certain word of knowledge just for me. Or he will have to point me out and come down and lead me by the hand. Are you? Come on now. Huh? I'm telling you, my heart is already stolen by some crippled people in Nepal that climbed the rig and dropped themselves just in front of us on the platform screaming, heal me. If you are not that hungry tonight, don't bother. If you're not that hungry tonight, you won't experience the deeper things of God. When will you see a healing? When you are ready to embarrass yourself? When you're ready to climb a rig? When you're ready? Are you getting it? When will you see a breakthrough? When you're ready to give it all? Hey, America. Hey, Europe. Let me speak to the Western world here for a while. Can I do that? No. I want a special appointment with the priest. Yeah, closed room where no one can hear me or no one can see or hear what I'm going to talk about. What are you talking about? I don't have time for that. Go to the movies or something. No, I mean it. Go to Cheesecake Factory or whatever it's called and go do something. I don't have time for that. I'm flying out to Africa tomorrow. Where I will meet with some hungry crowds. Where I will meet with some people that are ready to climb a rig. Where I'm ready to meet with people that are ready to storm a barricade. I don't got time for this nonsense. I don't got time for that. I got my dignity. I got my integrity right here. Just sit. Yeah, just sit. You don't qualify for what we're talking about here. How much, Jesus said, do you want to get well? Want to get well? I've been here 30 years. Yes, but I'm here now. No, I'm going to. Don't get me off balance here. The water is going to be stirred. The angel will go. I will get down. I'm here. Take up your mat. You're not even going to lay hands upon me. No.
You will take up your mat right now and you're going to walk out of here. We're not even going to anoint you with oil. You will take up your mat and you will walk out of here. Pastor Paul, he said, please preach like you do in the festivals. Pastor Kim said, please, and now I'm doing it. And can I continue? We need some aggressive faith around America and Europe and the Western world. We need some sold out people that are not just saying, you know, if it is the will of God. It might be, I don't know, it might be the will of God for me to be this way, or it might not, I don't know really, but I mean, sometimes, if it is the way, you know that, how many of you understand that's not faith? I sat next to a guy in Africa once, and we were in a hurry to get somewhere, and he was supposed to drive me. And I was so frustrated with him. Finally, I said, could you just stop here? I need to take a photo. It's a beautiful scenery. Yeah, yeah, we stopped. Let's get out of the car. We got out of the car. When he got out of the car, I jumped into the steering wheel. I started a car, and I was about to drive off, and he had to jump in next to me. I'm the driver. No, you're not the driver anymore, because I want to get to where I'm going, and I want to get there before it's too late. You're not driving this car anymore. We need some people like that. Are you hearing me? People that takes control of the situation. People that gets behind the steering wheel. People that wants a gear stick in their hand. People that wants to drive. Are you getting this? Well, if it is the will of God that I should get in time, if I should be part of this or not, when you know that you are going to be there, it's important for you to be there. Then you kick that driver out if you have to, and you get behind the steering wheel and get to where you're going. How many of you have heard about the four people that were carrying a paralyzed man to Jesus and couldn't get in? Oh, that's a great story. I know that one. It's from Mark's Gospel, chapter 2. Yeah, you're right. I mean, it's fun to read about that as long as it isn't our church. Isn't it? Chainsaw starting. Isn't it? Huh? Huh? Sawdust and stuff coming down the ceiling. Can you see it? Can you see? Can you see? What are they doing? They're breaking in. And you know, Jesus loved that. He got triggered by that. The Bible says he saw their faith. How did he see their faith? He heard their faith. He saw their faith. Oh, faith is an abstract, invisible thing. I got faith on the inside. Faith is a private matter. What are you talking about? You're humanistic, destroyed. You've lost way here. What are you talking about? Faith is heard. Faith is seen. Faith breaks through a roof. No, not really. Not the way I see it. Get around the Gospels, my friend. Faith is radical. Jesus loved the fact that they broke through a roof. We need some of those people. I learned it when I was under Reinhard Bonnke, my spiritual dad, that he said always, don't bother with people until they have the true hunger. Don't waste your time on people that don't have the true hunger. They would throw the cripples into the meetings and they would run. Yeah.
I never forget in Bolivia when we were down there among those Indians towards the border of Paraguay, in Gran Chaco, the Green Hell, as they called it. And there was one family, they were living off of selling honey. They were bee farmers. And they sold 1 year's income to get their son to my meeting. Their son was paralyzed, 22 years old. So they got hold of a car, and they had to drive 3 hours through the jungle to the meeting. And the boy didn't walk that night. They had to take him back in the car to the village. Then they borrowed honey from all of the neighbors. Sold another year's wages. You got to understand that now it starts to qualify for hunger. Mm-hmm. So now they were in debt for 2 years. They drove there with all their faith, crying, praying to God. And when they came in the second night and they told me that what the parents had done, we got desperate. How many of you know that something happens when you get desperate? Something happens when you're ready to break through a roof. Something happens when you're not waiting behind a barrier. Something happens. You will stir Jesus like a blind Bartimaeus. You will stir Jesus. You will shout so loud, He will get your attention. You say, why is it that way? Well, you see, He responds to faith. Jesus loves faith. It is impossible to please God without faith. And those that come to Him must believe that He earnestly rewards those that seek Him, isn't it? It's a beautiful thing to have faith. And that night, that young man was running. He was running all over. Yeah. The power. I know I don't dare to say it almost because it's so radical, but there's power in faith. Mm-hmm. There's power in Jesus, but there's power in faith too. And when you put your faith into action, things will happen. You know that people that don't have Jesus but have radical faith achieve things. I've met Muslims that seems to have more faith in doing business than Christians. I met people that have faith for all kinds of crazy things. Faith will move mountains one way or another. Faith will change things. But when you put Jesus into the equation of faith, everything is possible. Nothing is impossible. Everything is impossible. I love that Jesus is so full of faith. He walks on water, raises the dead. Is there anyone else in here that is in love with Jesus? I'm getting middle-aged slowly by slowly. I tried to deny it, but my wife is reminding me. But I'm telling you one thing. I'm getting more and more in love with Jesus. When you talk about Jesus with me, there's tears in my eyes. When you tell me about Jesus, oh, I'm soft. I always tell my 17-year-old daughter, I tell her, if you want to get your way with your daddy, talk about Jesus. So when she tells me something amazing that she's experienced with Jesus, then it's so easy to get $100 out of me. Because when it comes to Jesus, I'm soft-hearted. I love Him. I'm in love with Him. He took me from nothing. My father was a gangster. My mother was an alcoholic. We wouldn't have been alive if it wasn't for Jesus. Jesus did what no shrink could do, what no rehab could do. Are you here? Jesus did what no one else could do in my life, what no pills could do, what no lawyers could do, Jesus did. What no therapy could do, Jesus did. I was that boy that went to the shrink almost every week in high school, you know? I was that boy that, you know, that he, yeah. Is he drunk again? Is that why he's shouting so loud in English class? Is he what? Can someone check his bag? Oh, beers again.
I was the hopeless case. But then Jesus entered my life. Then Jesus came on my waters. Then Jesus shouted my name, and everything was changed. When Jesus enters your world, aggressive faith enters your world. Jesus is rather picky. What do you mean by that? Well, he chooses to manifest when it comes to his spirit and his power and his gifts through those channels that are most ready for it and most eager for it. He has an option as soon as we become two. And we are three in the room. Now there are three options. And when there are five, there are five, and so on. And he will pick the most red hot, the most, that one most ready to be used. Sometimes this freaks people out, doesn't it? That God uses, even sometimes as we've seen, Muslims, Hindus, that God uses prostitutes, that God uses drug addicts, that God uses sinners. Are you here? But you see, he responds to faith. Sometimes the Muslims receive the healing so much faster than the Christians. Sometimes there's just something about a Hindu crowd. I'd rather have those unreached. Are you here? I'd rather have those crowds any day. I'd rather have them than lukewarm. Are you here now? Pentecostal that knows it all. People that knows everything. That can quote every scripture. This is the way it's going to happen. Play the strings. This is the way it's going to happen. You know? Play a little soft on the piano. This is the way it's going to happen. Put the dim light on, you know, dim the light. This is not the way it's going to happen. This is how it will come. No. It may not come that way at all. You might miss the whole thing. Jesus can stand in front of you in a loud teenager. Jesus can stand in front of you, are you hearing me, in a prostitute. Jesus can stand in front of you and just speak something. I've heard Jesus through the Muslims and their hunger. I've seen Jesus in a Hindu crowd when the healings just comes like a, you know, there's just this grenade exploding and there are healings everywhere. All right, some of you are not getting what I'm saying, but it doesn't matter. I will preach this. Can I preach this now? Can I just do it? Listen, when Jesus raised the dead girl, he was ignoring the people shouting, screaming, wailing, and laughing. Real faith ignores laughter. Real faith ignores but if I speak about Jesus, people might laugh.
Yeah.
If I speak about Jesus, I can get killed. Are you getting the difference? What is a smile or a laughter? I got relatives, they still have that smile on their face. This intellectual smile. But who will have their boring lives? Huh? I see miracles every week. I hear the Holy Spirit. I'm on a faith adventure every week. Who would like to have two cars in the garage and a brand new kitchen? And come on now. Can we talk? I wouldn't trade it for anything. And I'm telling them openly. Yeah. When Jesus raised that dead girl, they were laughing. They were wailing. They were crying. But Jesus ignored them all. And he put everyone out. They were laughing and wailing. And he went in with the most hungry, with the most devoted. And a dead girl was raised. And I believe Jesus is looking for people that will ignore the laughs, that will ignore the wailings and the how shall I say, the complaints. Don't whine. Believe. Don't whine all the time. Believe. You've not experienced anything yet. Oh, no, the price has been too high. No, no, my friend. Your car is not burning yet. Your house has not been burned to the ground yet. The church is not in flames. But I've seen faith in a parking lot where the church has been burned down. And I've seen faith where people live in tents. Do you remember when we were in that tent camp? They were dancing in that tent camp. They were experiencing the miracles in that tent camp. They had nothing. They had lost all. But they were dancing. There needs to be faith enough that it breaks through. How shall I say? A little being smacked around. How shall I say this? I had a harsh daddy. Sometimes my wife says, you should not go there. Well, he was not so Jesus-like when I grew up. He raised me with his fists. He was a South European, and he said, it's better you have a nosebleed in this kitchen than you have it out there. Hey, boy, come on now. Bang, bang, bang. Come on now. Defend yourself. Come on now. And I don't know, people say I shouldn't say it, but it created something in me. Created something in me. It did something in me that God has used these years. If laughing is all you can do, I will walk right through. If whining is all you can do, we are walking right through. If you want to slap me around, slap me around. We can take a black eye too. We are walking through. Are you hearing me? Stones, let them hurl. Okay? Come on now, rocks, let them come. I never forget when they were crushing every car window, when they run axes into our tires. But the miracles in the evenings, oh, were explosive. I never forget when they crushed the skull of our team member. Oh, that would be a time to break and go home. No, that was a time to raise up. That was a time to continue. That was a time to break forth. Some of you are saying you're radical now. You bet I've not even started. No. I mean it. We've not started. I want real disciples, Jesus' disciples that are ready to give their lives. And there's this thing here that we need to get out, this wimpiness. You know? Know what I'm saying? Huh? This new thing that has flooded the Western world. Huh? This metrosexual wimpiness. We need to get out of people. Bang, 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 you know? Yeah. Faith. The boy that cries out for water, you've heard me tell this story. I've tucked you in sleep now, the daddy says, because he's watching Super Bowl, right? But the guy cries out again, Daddy, I'm so thirsty. I mean it. I just need a glass of water. After three times, the daddy shouts, if you don't shut up, you will feel the back of my hand. And then they can hear the boy again. I love this story. Can hear the boy again after a while. Daddy, I'm ready for that spanking now, but when you come to spank me, bring a glass of water, will you? Do you get what I'm saying? People are too wimpy. When we want water, we want water. When we want the Holy Spirit, we are going after it. If we don't have a well, we will blow a well in the ground. We'll put dynamite into the ground. We're not waiting for the waves to surf. We throw in a hand grenade in the river and create a wave, and then we surf. Are you hearing me? We're not waiting for the right opportunity. We make the opportunities. We create them to happen because we are people of faith. Aggressive faith needs to flood the Western church, and then we would take a city, and then we would move mountains. Tonight I feel it in every fiber of my body. I feel that aggressive faith. I'm about to blow up like a Holy Ghost Taliban right here and now. I feel it all over. I know I should calm down. I know some of you think, Johannes, you're in America now. No, I'm in the embassy of God. There are the rules here. You cannot bury someone who is dancing. I've told you that before, haven't I? Can't bury someone who is dancing. You can't put sand and dirt on someone's shoulder that is dancing. And he will trample everything that was meant to bury him under his feet, and he will walk out of every pit and every grave because he's dancing. We need to be wild dancers of faith, jugglers, survivors. It's too much now. It will be more. But the glory will grow too. The joy will grow too. The power will grow too. This is not for the weak-hearted. This is for the strong. This is for... And some say, Johannes. You see, faith will make you someone else. And if you're sitting in this room today and you feel, I don't qualify, I can't be here, shouldn't be here. This is not a sermon for me. Let me tell you something. When Jesus steps into your scene, everything changes. When Jesus steps into your scene, you become someone else. Come follow me and I will make you, Jesus said to Peter. Come follow me and I will transform you. He transformed me. He will transform you. You got better odds than me. Oh yeah, I got everything against me. I can tell you that for sure. Yeah. You know, I know you have your different expressions here in America, right? When you talk about ghetto. Huh? You have your different expressions. You talk about white trash, and isn't it? Oh yeah. You know, I was white trash times three. All right? Everything was just wrong. But Jesus lifted me out of all that. He lifted me out of all that. And today I feel I'm moving like an ambassador for Jesus Christ. Today I feel, oh. You know, let me just say this. I wouldn't trade my life. I love what Billy Graham once said when they asked him if he should run for presidency. Have you heard that? Huh? Why should I step down to a lower office? I am an evangelist. That's how I feel. You couldn't tempt me because this is the life I've chosen. This is the life I'm living. Whoever you are, listen, if you're a doctor, a lawyer, if you have a well-paid company, you see, you are doing it. You are breaking forth. You're doing all kinds. Listen, all of that will gain for nothing, if you aren't sold out for Jesus. But if you sold out for Jesus, you can use all of that for something wonderful. Who cares about your title? What God cares about is hunger. And when hunger is there and radical hunger is there, He will use a doctor as He will use a ghetto boy. Are you here? He will use a lawyer as He uses a carpenter. Nah, God is no respecter of person. We always say, that's right. But he responds to faith. That's the difference. Oh, yeah. Class has got nothing to do with it. Race has got nothing to do with it. Age has got nothing to do with it. But he responds to faith. And when faith is there, everything is possible. All right, okay. I'm coming to where I need to go. When we were among the headhunter tribes in the Philippines, far up in the jungle, there was a man that impressed us so much. He became like a mascot to the team. He was a former headhunter. And he was the first one to respond to every invitation I made after preaching. On everything. Everything, everything. And he was mad with the others for not responding. Me and my interpreter, we laughed so hard because he went around and yelled at people for them being so stupid not walking up to the front to be prayed for. He told his sister, he was 72, this man, he told his sister, "Are you stupid or what?" The interpreter interpreted to me. And he was laughing. He could not interpret for me anymore because he stood there. "Are you stupid or what? He's praying for the sick now. I'm not going to carry water for you anymore, just so that you know. When you have a chance to be healed, I'm not going to carry firewood for you anymore. Are you still, why are you sitting there? What's the matter with you?" And this is how he responded to everything. He was crazy. He was on fire. He had faith. I've never seen a Pentecostal that on fire. But this former headhunter, this guy, can you see, from a tribe in the jungle, he slept at the riverbank because he wanted to be the first one baptized.
Are you hearing me?
He was the first one. Afterwards, he said to me, "Are you going to make any other invitations, or can I go home and just change? I don't want to miss anything." Are you hearing me? I don't want that ridiculous thing here tonight. Are you hearing me? I'm thinking, I'm debating on the inside if I should go more radical on you or if this is enough. Shall I go? Huh? I don't even want you to walk up on the altar invitation tonight. You don't qualify. I want you to run. If you are a slow responder tonight, you are not my priority. Okay? Let me say it again. Let me just say it again. Okay? Let me rephrase it a little bit so that I really speak English. If you are chewing a gum in my salvation line, I will ask you to go down and sit. Are you hearing me? Because Jesus is holy to me. Are you hearing me? Listen up now. Listen up now. If you're talking to your neighbor as you're standing up here, go down. All right? We want holy fear in this room. We want radical, sold out hunger for Jesus in this room. Nothing else. And when that is there, we don't even need to lay hands upon people. They receive the healing. We need to do nothing. Demons are just running, fleeing. We need to do nothing. You baptized in the Holy Spirit, and everything is possible. When that atmosphere is there, there is this thing here that needs to be uprooted. Sometimes there is more God fear in my Catholic relatives down in South Europe than there are in Pentecostal churches. Can I speak about this? I start to speak about the miraculous. And they put the cigarette out. They put the beer to the side. One uncle said, "This is too holy. Put your cigarettes out. This is too holy. We will drink beers later." The boy is telling holy stuff now. This is my father's cousin. And then someone was talking, "Shut up. I'm the oldest in the room." And this boy is telling holy stuff now. Tears in their eyes. "Johannes," they say. "Johannes, pray for me. no, I've not been the best one, but pray for me. You don't have to tell me I'm a sinner because I know I am a sinner, but pray for me. Sometimes there is more hunger, more fear of God among my beer-drinking, cussing Catholic relatives than there are in cool, hip Pentecostal churches in Western Europe and America. They don't respond if there isn't the coolest light or the coolest, you know, smoke on stage. They don't even respond if it isn't really their brand of worship. Are you hearing me? If it isn't really, you know, huh? The codes. Who cares about the codes? Who cares about your little codes? Huh? Well, let me talk now. Let me speak this that it is said. Hunger. Couldn't care about how the preacher is dressed. Hunger. Couldn't care about how the light is set. Hunger. Are you here? Couldn't care about it if it is an electric guitar or a Hammond organ. Are you here? Hunger. Response. Hunger runs. Hunger cries. Hunger humbles himself. Hunger would listen to someone old that speaks the gospel. Someone young that speaks the gospel. Someone uneducated that speaks the gospel. Someone that doesn't qualify to speak the gospel. Because hunger knows that I can receive from Jesus no matter. This may not be the cleanest vessel, but I know I will receive from Jesus. Hunger will respond. Ah, there's something in the air right now that is breaking the religious, charismatic demons. Are you hearing me? Yeah. Are they there? They are there too. You see, there is something that we need to aim at tonight. Very, very soon we are going to pray. And Jesus will walk this building. I'm not needed. He will walk this building. You will see his nail marks. You will see deep into his eyes. You will fall down in reverence. And you will love him. And you will follow him. And you will give your life for him. Tonight, no more games. Tonight, we are skipping through some stuff here, okay? Can I speak with you? Tonight, we are getting to know one another for real. Johannes and Fresh Start. Tonight, I want to speak this and I want to have it said. Are you hearing me? Tonight, it's going to be said, and this is it. You are not on anyone's priority list. Not on God's. Not on the preachers, not on the pastors, until you show some hunger. When the urge shall I go for dinner with you just because you can't come to church because you want your private sessions? Why an urge shall I, you know, because you have a big bank account or wallet? I gotta tell you something. My God is my source and not you. Yeah. The Holy Spirit is going to move in this place. Not because I preached good, but because Jesus is Jesus. And the Holy Spirit is going to move here tonight because there will be no chewing of gums.
I'm saved, but I just want the hunger back.
Beautiful.
I want the hunger back.
Put your, yeah, just kneel down here. Worship team, let's get up here. Yeah. Yeah. I once read a story about Lester Sumrall. How many of you know Lester Sumrall, who he was? An old legendary Pentecostal preacher, then a Word of Faith preacher. He waited until people walked after him in the village.
He preached the gospel for weeks without making any invitations to come right with God, until people walked after him in that village saying, please, please, pray with me. Help me to get right with God. We're making salvation too easy. And that's why we have lukewarm Christians and lukewarm salvations. Tonight, my invitation goes like this. If you're ready to die, if you're ready to give your life, if you're ready to give 100%, you will receive it. Tonight, my invitation goes like this. How much do you want it? How much? Jesus comes to your pool. How much? He stands right there and he says, pick up your mat, walk now. Here comes the power of the Holy Spirit. Lift up your hands. Here it is. Raw! Holy Spirit power. Raw streams of the Holy Spirit. The blood power. The Jesus power that breaks chains, kills demons, heals the sick, baptizes you in the Spirit, fills you with hunger, with passion, with compassion, with love, with devotion. What did we say, Paul? Hashtag 10% is ridiculous. 100% or nothing. 100% or nothing. Here we are, Lord, sold out. Here we are, Lord, ready to take the gospel to Phoenix, to Arizona, to the States. Here we are, Lord, ready to take the gospel to Africa, to Europe, to Asia. Here we are, Lord, ready to carry your gospel. God will respond, Kim, to the intercession and to the warfare and to the prayers. God will respond, and he will respond with raw hunger. Don't give up, says the Holy Spirit, Kim. Don't give up. Keep on pressing. Keep on moving. Keep on shouting. Keep on moving. Keep on shouting. Keep on pressing. Because God will let raw hunger be stirred. Not after bread, not after water, but after the Word of God. There'll be famine in Arizona. Not a natural famine, but a spiritual famine. And all those people that have just been served Christianity light, they will come for real bread and for real water. They will come to experience the gospel. Lift up, lift up, lift up, lift up, lift up, lift up, lift up your spirit, lift up your spirit, lift up your spirit to Jesus. Touch Jesus. Give him promises tonight. Talk to him tonight. Say, my wallet belongs to you. My bank account belongs to you. Everything belongs to you. My family belongs to you. My time belongs to you. Take it, Lord. Take it, Lord. Take my life, oh God. Take it, Lord. I want to burn like a torch in the nations. I want to burn until I got nothing left. I want to shine for you in a dark world. I want to preach you to a dying world. Everything happens right here and around these altars right now. Healings are taking place. Deliverance are taking place. Baptism in the Holy Spirit takes place. If you never spoke in tongues, start to speak in tongues right now. Oh, if you need a healing, grab that healing right now. It's yours. You're receiving it right now. You need a deliverance, say, Jesus, right here in this atmosphere, deliver me.